Yeah.
And then I start seeing like oil slicks in different patterns. And when I'm with people and everybody's looking and we relax and keep quiet, you'll see it. So it's an interesting thing I give you now. And trust me, if you take your time, you'll see it. And we're not crazy. It's a wonderful thing. The veils are thinning. We are all moving into a higher consciousness. And the more we look, the more we see.
Yes, I agree with you on that one.
It's cool.
Yes, and thank goodness for people like yourself who point these things out and allow us or give us permission to look and to see and to realize that we're not crazy, that we are really seeing something there. And it's just the beginning. I mean, we may be seeing things so strange and unusual in the near future that we may think we are insane.
I don't know. I meet a lot of people who are seeing things far more interesting than I've ever seen.
Well, and of course, you know that ETs are here in human form, too, so...
Yeah.
I haven't necessarily met any that I know of, but I'm pretty certain that many have incarnated in order to help the planet raise her vibration and continue moving in that direction into a higher realm.
Yes. And if you want to meet some, just head over to the crop circle area. So the area is not full of a lot of people. There's not many tourists. You either come over for a crop circle tour, or
yeah,
you are one of us in the front line that's just dirty knees, muddy boots, you know, out there every morning first thing before people get in it. Many of the farmers are honorable about it. Some of them even stick out a coin box and ask you to drop a pound or two into the box, and they hope to maybe get some of their money back. And as long as people go down the tram lines, which are the tractor lines, it doesn't hurt a whole lot of their wheat or barley, and when it's fall and autumn, they mow the entire field anyway, and even the laid crop, they mow, and I would think, my God, that's helping humanity ascend. If that's some really good, buzzy crop, my goodness, think of the beer that might make. We got crop circle beer here.
My goodness, that sounds pretty tasty to me.
I mean, that should be sold by the dropper full.
Oh, my goodness.
The
well,
teaspoon.
Where can you get that?
Yeah, no kidding. Well, I said that to the farmer. So I had some interesting experiences with the farmers over there.
Uh-huh.
There was one day I set out to interview, I'll just say his first name, Charlie, and this guy has been mowing down the finest crop circles in Avebury for many, many years, as his father did before. And I don't think he had a whole lot of feeling about it, but I wasn't sure, so I called him up for an interview because I knew he was the guy. And he said, yeah, sure. So I met him at the barn, and I go to pull the camera out of the car. He was very nice, kind of full-figured and big pink cheeks, and he was right on time. It was neat. And there was the biggest tractor I have ever seen in front of his huge barn. So the setup was perfect, lighting was right. I pull the tripod out of the trunk, I go to put the camera on it, and it would not go on the tripod. My camera said no. And I was like, I turned it, I twisted it, I turned it over upside down, I was like pushing on the metal like, what the heck, you've never done this. And I kept trying to load it on. It was the weirdest thing. The camera would not behave and slide on the tripod. And he's watching, and I brought this friend as an assistant from the Netherlands, great lady, she wanted to be my helper. Can I help you? And I said, no, it's like totally misbehaving, but no problem. So I just kind of rammed it on and held it there, and I reached into the trunk with my other hand, like really holding both at the same time to grab the mics. And I've been filming for days. I mean, it's just flawless gear. I love it. So I pull the mics out and check, and hook him up, and mic wouldn't work. I was like, oh,
oh
no problem.
God.
Pulled out the other mic. Dead as a doornail.
Wow.
I was like, oh, God, this isn't easy with my fingers and Band-Aids. But damn it, I had grabbed all my batteries, and I replaced 16 batteries. The top of the camera and both the mics on the backpack of him, because I really like the sound of the lavalier mics. It's just clean. So I light up all the mics again with brand-new batteries, dead as a doornail.
Wow.
I was like, oh, my God. So I said to him, tell you what, I don't have a tripod, I don't have accessory mics. Let's just go inside your barn here, and I'll film you quietly just with the inside mic, and I'll stick my leg up on a chair, and I'll film you no problem like this. Oh, no, we can't go in the barn. I said, what do you mean? He said, we just sprayed in there. I said, well, what'd you spray? He said, well, we just can't go in the barn. I said, well, isn't that where the wheat goes in a few minutes? And he said, yeah, we just sprayed the wheat, too. I said, what'd you spray the wheat with? He said, well, you know, we have to spray it with something to lay it down and spray it with something to get it to be ready for the harvest, and they spray it with something else to keep the bugs off it, and then they spray the barn before the wheat comes in there, and then they harvest it all and load it in the barn, and all these sprays are most likely what's going on, why people are allergic to wheat, when I don't think it's really the wheat they're allergic to. I think it's something unfortunate that they've agreed to do to our wheat. And I hope this isn't really scary of me to say on the air, but this is a physical thing that happened to me in England, one of the things I didn't love last summer. When I go in every crop circle, I like to cut one head that represents to me that crop circle, and I send it home. So I've got one beautiful head of each crop circle I've been in. And I was saving them last summer up in this plastic bucket up in my closet so that at the end of the summer I just send them through. And when I went to, not to the crop circles for a couple days, I went and did something else. Then I came back. At the end of the day, I went to put my little head in this bucket that had all my lovely little barley heads. I pulled it down from my closet, and it had grown the scariest fungus I had ever seen in a day.
Whoa.
It was like pink cotton candy, and it filled this strawberry plastic bucket to explode.
Wow.
And now, this happened to me. That's all I can say. And I threw the bucket away, and I should have given it to somebody to take a look at it, because whatever they're spraying on the wheat made that pink stuff happen in my bucket. So for that reason, and the helicopters that circled me when I was filming Patricia Corey, they circled us for 25 minutes after the first helicopter came in for 5 minutes, finally flew away. I started up the camera, another helicopter flew in and just stayed on top of us for 25 minutes with a red laser locked on us, just circling and circling, and two somethings pointed at us. I don't know if they were cameras or guns, but they were really intimidating, and Patricia said, don't let it bother you. But, you know, it's like I'm a peaceful person.
Right,
I come here for the most magnificent artwork that's being done in the tapestry of southern England. I mean, it is so beautiful. But I think that because it's such intense, advanced information that is happening now, I mean, these crop circles are the first physical manifestation that humans can physically see of communications from another realm. These are definitely, in my opinion, ET gifts. Some are being made by humans, but certainly not all the good ones.
No, not at all. Impossible.
It's not humanly possible.
No. In fact, did you see the one film where there are light orbs that circle over the crop, over the wheat, and within minutes, the whole crop circle is formed, and then the lights disappear.
Now, it wasn't really minutes, was it? It was seconds.
Seconds, that's right. It was seconds, you're right.
It was seconds.
Yeah.
So this is the famous John Whaley footage.
At the end of
my crop circle movie?
Yeah.
The most amazing footage. And I had a discovery. Again, I think my little buddies handed me this. It's just crazy. But for years, since I think it's 1986 or 96, near Oliver's Castle, which is in southern England in this area, John Whaley, this guy, was sitting on the hill like we did night after night after night. We call ourselves crappies. And it's just an addiction when you're over there, which I did all summer for a couple of years in a row.
Yeah.
You're in the fields all day hiking till you fall over, and then you sit on the hills at night waiting to see the balls of light.
Oh.
You know, I mean, it's really exciting, and you know you're in it because it just feels eerie.
Yeah.
And I only say eerie because there's not a word I can come up with, but we saw lights at a distance every night we sat out. But most of the people I interviewed have seen them close up because they've been going for 15, 20 years.
Wow. What do they look like close up?
They look like light, like really bright light, and it shines a light on you to like where you feel as if you're under a spotlight.
Wow.
And they always, typically people have said that it's three lights coming up, and they're always in a triangle formation, and then when the craft gets closer, the three lights dim down, and there's an amberish rim, a circle around the round disc.
Huh.
So when they first advance, they look like a triangle, but when they show up, they're actually a disc. I've heard that story from more people than anything else.
Huh. Wow.
And the craft circle, so this film with John Whaley, most amazing story. Typically, when these balls of light come into a place where humans are, like my example in my bed, I was sleeping, my boyfriend was awakened because I started talking in my sleep before they came in the room. Very odd night. He said, "You woke me up by saying, it's not what you see, it's what you don't see."
Wow.
I'm like, come on. He said, "Oh, no, that's not all." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Then you kept me awake because you kept talking in your sleep." I was like, come on. Then you said, "It's not who you know, it's who you really are."
And that's in the beginning of your movie.
It's in the beginning of all my movies because it's a message I guess they gave me years ago.
Wow.
And it's really odd as I'm making these movies, which is so darn fun. I keep saying, jokingly, but kind of real, I do as I'm told.
Huh.
I mean, I really listen because my hands are still hurt, so I'm not wasting my time shopping and waving and shaking hands and being social. That's not a waste for many, many, many people. That's a fabulous life to be popular and busy and important.
Right.
For me now, I live in nature over a river in the woods in Colorado, up in the Rocky Mountains, and I don't want to come off the hill.
Well, I'm the
same
way. My
lovely editor,
I'm the same way. I live in nature, and I don't want to come off of my property.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I'm a recluse.
I know. Well, the movie that I'm making now, my fourth movie, is about the fairy kingdom and the elves.
Oh, tell me about that.
Oh, it's really, really lovely. I filmed a lot of it in England when I filmed 2012. I was like, I mean, I'm humorous. I do the job of, like, all the film crew because I don't have rules and I'm fully undisciplined and something is guiding me amazingly well. So when I went over there, I wasn't sure if I was making a fairy film or a 2012 movie, but my friend who I do music with, Nick Ashren, who's in two of my movies, said, "Hey, mate, I'm playing music in a fairy festival. Why don't you come over and begin your summer here with me?" So I flew over May 22nd. On that last summer, and met him at a fairy festival, and that was the beginning of seeing how people live that truly have the life of being fairies in their minds, and getting into talking to them and finding out how they assimilate into society. And the interesting thing is that there are people that really have wings, you know, that they put on, that have things that go over your shoulders, yes. But they really have a lot more connection to the earth. And they go to these festivals almost to, like, connect into their tribe. And there was something definitely more angelic about these interesting, kind of mid-worldly people when I was there. I could tell again that, you know, I'm going, is this just English, or are these people all really in another dimension?
Yeah.
And they really are. So the fairy film, I wasn't sure I was going to make, but everywhere I went, got a camera, may as well start shooting. You know, I brought way too many rolls of film.
Yeah.
And because I was followed around so much by the helicopters every frigging where I went, I wanted to make sure that, of course, I was coming home safely, but I kept FedExing groups of my tapes back to America, so in case I didn't make it, you know what I'm saying? It was like it really made me uncomfortable as a woman traveling alone and as a kind, loving human being.
Yes. And
that's why I'm not there this summer. I just had enough of that.
Yeah. There, you know, I think a lot of people